Welcome to the Efficient eLearning SAP Training Series. This video is SAP Accounts Payable, Transaction FB65, Post-Vendor Credit Memo. And here's a list of our topics. First up, we'll confirm where transaction code FB65 fits in the procure-to-pay process, followed by an explanation of the difference between a non-PO credit memo and a credit memo referencing a purchase order. Then it's on to the practical component of the video, posting a non-PO credit memo using transaction FB65 in SAP. Once the credit memo is posted, we'll then analyse the vendor line item display, transaction FBL1N. Let's begin with where transaction FB65 fits in the procure-to-pay process. At this point, it's probably useful to mention that a lot of organizations use the term credit note rather than credit memo. Credit memo is SAP's chosen term for this type of document. However, the two terms are interchangeable. Either one is acceptable. In this video, I'll make use of both terms. Now let's take a look at the procure-to-pay process. Note that a non-PO credit memo does not reference a purchase order, so the procurement steps in the procure-to-pay process: create purchase requisition, approve purchase requisition, convert requisition to purchase order, and post goods receipt are not relevant. Transaction FB65 sits within the post-vendor invoice step and is completed by the accounts payable department. Okay, so we've established where transaction FB65 fits in the procure-to-pay process. Now let's discuss the difference between a non-PO credit memo and a credit memo referencing a purchase order. Here's the two documents side by side. Note the difference in color scheme between the invoice document that has blue heading backgrounds and the credit note document that has red heading backgrounds. Some vendors use a different color scheme on credit notes to ensure the document is not accidentally posted as an invoice. But within the credit memo scenarios, visually, the only real difference is the purchase order field. As you would expect, for a non-PO credit memo, this field is blank. Conversely, for a credit memo referencing a purchase order, the field is populated with the relevant purchase order number. So why do some credit memos reference a purchase order and others don't? Some organizations have a strict policy. All invoices and credit notes must reference a purchase order or they cannot be processed. But typically, most organizations will require the majority of invoices and credit notes to reference a purchase order, with some limited exceptions. In this fictitious company example, invoices and credit notes for mobile phone plan costs are a permitted exception. That is, invoices and credit notes don't require a purchase order. However, the purchase of mobile phone handsets still requires a purchase order. In this video, the focus is on posting a non-PO credit memo, so we can discard the credit note referencing a purchase order. Now that we have our credit note, we can process it in SAP using transaction FB65. When processing accounts payable credit notes, I tend to display the credit note to the left and the SAP screen to the right. Before we start, I'll explain the reason for the credit note. The original invoice charged for 10 mobile phone plans. However, this was an overcharge. It should have only been for 8 mobile phone plans. The vendor has sent a credit note for the excess plans to offset the value on the original invoice. Let's now process the credit memo in SAP. If you're new to SAP, it's worth noting where transaction FB65 resides in the SAP standard menu. Start with the accounting folder, then financial accounting, accounts payable, and document entry. Now you can simply double-click on this entry to open the transaction, However, as I'm going to be using this transaction frequently, I'll create a favorite for the transaction. To create the favorite, right-click on the entry and choose Add to Favorites. I'm not happy with the standard description for the favorite, so I'll right-click on the entry and choose Change Favorite. I can now change the description. I'll rename the entry Post Non-PO Credit Memo and then click Continue. I'm also not happy with the position of the favorite in the Favorites folder, so I'm going to click and drag the favorite and release the mouse button on top of the FB60 favorite. This will insert the favorite below FB60. I can now double-click on this favorite to open the transaction. Always make note of the company code. If the company code is not correct, you can switch company code using this button on the application toolbar. In this example, the company code is correct, so there's no need to change it. The first field we need to populate is the vendor field. If you know the vendor code, you can simply type it in this field. If you don't know the vendor code, you can search for the vendor by clicking in the vendor field and clicking the drop-down list to the right. This displays the match codes or search helps for the vendor field. Note the vendor name from the credit note, XYZ Mobile. Simply type XYZ asterisk in the name field and click the Start Search button. The desired vendor is listed in the search results. Double-click on the relevant vendor code to select it. Next up is the Document Date field. This is the date on the vendor credit note. Click in the Document Date field and enter the date referenced on the credit note. The reference field is the vendor's credit note number. Click in the reference field and type in the credit note number. The posting date is pre-populated with the current date. Normally this date isn't changed unless you're given specific instructions by the accounting department. For example, sometimes at month end an instruction is given to use the last date for the prior month until the prior period is closed. In this example, we'll simply leave it as the default. The amount field represents the gross amount of the credit note, so the net amount plus tax. Click in the amount field and type in the total value from the credit note. The tax amount field is the total tax value for the credit note. Again, click in the tax amount field and type in the value from the credit note. To the right of the tax amount field is the tax code field at credit memo header level. If all of the lines on the credit note have the same tax code, you can enter that tax code in this field, and it will default to this value on all of the credit memo line items below. However, if not all of the line items have the same tax code, it's best to leave this tax code field at credit memo header level blank. In our example, there's only one line item, so we can input the tax code in this field. Based on the values on the credit note and experience of this type of purchase, the tax code should be P1, GST 10%. Now press the Enter key on the keyboard to validate the information entered. Note the warning message at the bottom of the screen indicating the credit note is overdue. Press the Enter key again to bypass the warning message. The credit memo header details are now complete. We can now move on to the credit memo line items. This is where we enter the line item values and account assignment details. In this example, a cost center and a general ledger account. click in the GL account field. Again, if you know the GL account code, you can simply enter it manually here. However, in this example, we'll assume we have to search for the codes. Click the drop-down list to the right of the field. In the GL long text field, type TEL asterisk and then click the Start Search button. Double-click on the GL account for telephone rental. Now click in the Amount field and enter the net amount for the line item, excluding tax. And finally, click in the Cost Center field and click the drop-down list to the right. In the Cost Center Short Text field, type Admin asterisk and then click the Start Search button. Double-click on the Administration Cost Center. Now press the Enter key on the keyboard to validate the entered values. As the balance of the credit memo is zero, and there are no error messages displayed, we can now click the Post button to post the vendor credit memo. Note the internal SAP document number for the credit memo at the bottom of the screen. Now the credit memo has been posted, we can view it on the vendor line item display, transaction FBL1N. We can now use our favorite for transaction FBL1N. Double-click on this favorite to open the transaction. I know the company code, so that's definitely correct. However, I don't know the vendor code. Click the drop-down list to the right of the vendor field. Click in the name field and type XYZ asterisk, then click the Start Search button. Double-click on the entry for XYZ Mobile. We can now choose the line item selection. There are three choices: open items, cleared items, and all items. I'd like to see both open items and cleared items, so I'll choose all items. Now we move down to the type section. Both invoices and credit memos are normal items, which is the default selection, so I'll leave this section as it is. I can now click the Execute button to run the report. This is the original invoice, and this is the credit memo we just processed. A couple of important things to note. Invoices have a negative value in this report, representing a credit value to reflect the liability to the vendor. Credit memos offset or reduce the total value owed, so these have the opposite sign, to reflect the debit value. Additionally, note the credit memo has no payment terms. This is standard behavior to ensure the credit memo is immediately due and will be included in the next payment run, as often the original invoice has already been paid. That's all for this video. Remember to give it a like and subscribe to the channel if you'd like to be notified when new videos are uploaded. As always, thanks for watching.